Okay, let us start by sharing my screen. So I will share my PPT so that it will be easier. Yes. So my dear friends, first I would like to welcome you all, including your renowned principal, Dr. Subhash Vaghe sir, and the coordinator teachers, Dr. Sheetal madam and Dr. Dangi madam. So myself is Professor Dr. Rajendra Deshpande. I am MD in Ayurvedic Medicine and MD in Ayurvedic Physiology, that is Kriya Sharira. And today's my topic, which I have chosen, and Dr. Vaghe sir has given kindly permission to go with my topic, that is Ayurvedic terminology, and I call it as Ayurvedic language. I will explain why I have used this particular Ayurvedic language word. Because you may be knowing about Hindi language, especially Nagpur is famous for Hindi. Then you may be knowing English very well, it's an international language. You may be some knowing another languages if you are coming from Maharashtra. Maybe, of course, you are in Maharashtra, but Marathi language some people may be knowing. Bengali, Urdu, Kannadi. So India is a multilingual country, I can say. But now you have entered in the world where there is a special language, and that language is called as a Ayurvedic language. So now you will be 100% multilingual student and multilingual. Of course, the teachers are there who are already having multilingual techniques, that Sanskrit and Hindi and English. So this is my WhatsApp number. After my lecture, if anybody wants to contact me for his difficulties and suggestions and anything else, comments, they are always welcome to send me the WhatsApp 9226810630, and this is my mail ID. I will try to send this PPT to Dr. Vaghe sir or the coordinator, Dr. Sheetal madam, and they may, I allow them to circulate this particular PPT in the PDF form to all the students. I am very much pleased to get this particular thing done. Okay. Dr. Madam has already introduced me a lot, but to stress more about my post graduation, I am MD in Ayurvedic Medicine, that is Kaya Chikitsa subject and Kriya Charya. The most important point that I would like to know or inform you that now I have stopped writing the books because I am entering into the digital India. Digital India.
Correct.
Prime Minister Modi Sahib said digital India. So I am making digital Ayurveda. Try to understand. Dr. Deshpande is making digital Ayurveda by contributing on the YouTube. There are nearly 630 plus videos on my YouTube channel. You can kindly note this channel, Ayurveda Academy channel. And what is there? This channel is for students, for the teachers, for the doctors, and for everybody, for the common man as well. Because in this channel, you will find the playlist. Nearly 30 icons are there, starting from first year, second year, third year, fourth year BMS. Kriya Shari, Rachana Shari, Pathology, Roga Nidan, Panchakarma, each and everything you will get on my this particular channel. And I am delighted to do this work as a hobby because there is some modification in the introduction. At the moment, I can call as a ex-professor, because I have taken the voluntary retirement from my college at the age of 61. That is 1st of December 2019, sorry, 20, I have been retired, and now I am fully enjoying this my passion of making digital Ayurveda. Okay. So I first would like to thank Dr. Principal Dr. Subhash Vaghe sir, who is a really, really a dynamic personality in the field of Ayurveda, because I have personally experienced his very interesting skills. He himself has worked a lot as a consulting clinical physician in the cardiac hospitals. Try to understand. It's not an easy job to work in the heart hospital. And then he has contributed whatsoever his experience and knowledge by writing excellent books. Two or three examples I can give. One, he has written Cardiology in Ayurveda, number one. Recently, I have made a review on his latest book of his own subject, Roga Nidan, paper two. And also, I have found one interesting book that he has made differential diagnosis on the basis of Ayurveda. This is not possible in any of other books that I have found yet. But apart from Vaghe sir, because it's not a one-man army that one can do the success, but the staff that I'm looking over here, Dr. Sheetal madam and Dr. Dangi madam, and all the supporting staff, I am very much thankful to all of you by giving this nice opportunity to interact with the new admission students. So I will start my lecture with chanting the Dhanvantari prayer. So please sit down and close your eyes gently, and please sit straight, take a deep breath, and just listen what I am chanting. शङ्खं चक्रं जलौकां दधतमृतघटं चारुदौर्भिष्टतुर्भिः सूक्ष्मस्वच्छातिरुद्याशुक परिविलसं मौलिमं भोजनेत्रं कालाम्बुदोज्ज्वलाङ्गं कटितटविलसत् चारुपीताम्बराढ्यम् वंदे धन्वंतरिं तं निखिलगदवन प्रौढदावाग्निनीलम् ओम शांति शांति शांति। बो योर हेड डाउन। नमस्कार टू सैल्यूट धन्वंतरी गॉड ऑफ हेल्थ। हेड अप। स्लोली टेक योर हैंड डाउन। Slowly open your eyes, warm up your eyes with the heat of the palm. So this is the God Dhanvantri. I call it as the God of health. And in my YouTube channel, I have given a clear-cut symbolic meaning of this particular prayer. You can go and check it out there. Now, for the students, I congratulate all the students for their nice success and achievements. And they have chosen a very right course, that is Bachelor of Ayurvedic Medicine and Surgery. And they have admitted at the right center, Jupiter Ayurveda College. So, Ayurveda course, Ayurveda Vaidyas and Ayurveda consultants are now on the high demand from village to the global market. Now, we will start with the concept of Ayurveda. Ayurveda is now becoming, is not now, it's nearly about 10, 15 years, is becoming international language of healthcare system. Ayurveda, allopathy, homeopathy, naturopathy, each healthcare system, of course, everybody, each science has merits and demerits. So there should not be any superiority or inferiority complex to any pathy, to any student or to any doctor. But at the same time, we as Ayurvedician, you students, you teachers and myself should have the faith, shraddha chahiye, and proud of our mother Ayurveda. Like mother tongue, mother nation, this is our mother Ayurveda. But I feel allopathy, Ayurveda, homeopathy, which is the best pathy? Sympathy is the best pathy. So you choose whatever you want. Now, importance of language. Now, when you want to go to Germany for education or for service purpose, you learn definitely German. When you go to Spain, you learn Spanish. When you go to France, you learn the French language. Similarly, when you enter for the Ayurveda course, or now you are making your career in the Ayurveda, you will learn Ayurveda language. And Ayurvedic terminology is the fundamental, what you can say, the base of whole of your construction. In biology, because you have come from the 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 12, which is giving you the biological aspect. But I am very sorry to say, any government has not been yet succeeded to introduce Ayurvedic language, Ayurvedic concepts, Ayurvedic terminology from the school and college levels in India, especially in India. And that's why whenever any student after getting passed from 11, 12 enter into the Ayurveda, they get little bit to begin with, first 2-3 months, a quite speed breakers, quite hurdle in their process. And today, my lecture will become a, what you can say, the buffer, shock absorber. So when you hear this lecture, your next, all the lectures for the coming 15 days, as well as the next 4 years, you will be quite, what you can say, the settled with your mind, with lot of confidence. No, Dr. Deshpande has introduced these basic terms at its first level. Okay, so in biology, you have learned the concept cell. So when I say cell, when I say tissue, when I say organ, when I say respiratory system, nervous system, you don't get afraid. You do not get afraid. But when you hear any word of Ayurveda, for example, if you heard about kosha, If you hear about dhatu, if you hear about mala concept, then yes, your body and mind start shaking and you get confused whether I have entered into the right course or whether I should leave this particular course and quarantine. Don't do that. Don't do that. Because this Ayurvedic terminology, this Ayurvedic language is very, very, very easy than your mother tongue. You will grasp it within these 6 months. So this first lecture is a base of all those lectures. My dear friends, only the thing you have to remember that whenever we use Ayurvedic terminology, it has its own wide aspect. Now, when I am using or when I am explaining these terms, there may be little bit adulteration with the English language, with the adulteration of the modern medicine, with the adulteration of allopathy. So all my teachers of Jupiter College, Principal Sahib, should excuse me because this comparison is just for understanding. Students should be aware that when I am comparing terms, I am not making them equal to. Whatever the words I am using here henceforth, there is not equal to. They are parallel things. And if you understand parallel things and if you get the confidence, more than enough. That's why I am using this term. For example, when we say dosha, for example, these I consider as like a bioenergies. So vata, pitta and kapha, these are the bioenergies in our body. The dhatu, when you learn in Marathi language, dhatu is like gold and silver and copper. Those dhatus are not expected in the world dhatu when we learn Ayurveda in physiology or Kriyachari. There we understand body tissues. Body tissues word is known to the Ayurvedic students. But here they must be said that Ayurvedic dhatu is not equal to tissues, but definitely it is parallel to the concept of tissue. And when I say mala, it is parallel to the concept of waste products in Ayurveda. Now, next, do not get shocked and do not get panic. Not only about these gross elements, but when I use some words like indriya, when I say mana, how is your mind? When I say atma, don't get shocked. Do not get shocked with these words which you are hearing first time. Very soon, you will be adjusted with these terms and that can be your colloquial language where you will be comfortable. For example, now at present, I will say, we get Sinan. Danke schön. Vielen Dank. You will say, what Dr. Deshpande, what you say? We get, what is that? We get. So actually, I have used some German words. Any student who is knowing German, I am using the German word, we get a Sinan. How are you? But you get shocked because you are not, he have heard that word before. Similar is happening with the Ayurvedic thing. Now, about what is Ayurveda? Ayurveda word, how it is formed? Ayu and Veda. Ayu is a life and Veda is a knowledge. Remember this term. Ayu means life and Veda means knowledge. So Ayurveda is not only medical science, but it is a life science. So this is the Sanskrit quotation over there in Devanagari script. Ayushaha Vedaha Ayurvedaha. You can forget this Sanskrit lines. You will get this PPT PDF very soon from your coordinator. Now definition of Ayurveda. Hita ahitam sukham dukham ayustasya hita ahitam manam cha tachyatroktam Ayurvedaha suchyate. Again, don't get shocked by my Sanskrit lines because there are nearly 60-70% students who do not have Sanskrit knowledge in 8th, 9th, 10th, 11th, 12th. And when they hear, oh my God, Ayurveda is in Sanskrit? No, my dear friends. Ayurveda, his own language. Of course, Sanskrit is a mother tongue of Ayurveda. But that doesn't mean you cannot speak other than the Sanskrit. Original texts like Charaka, Sushruta, Vagbhata, they are in Sanskrit, but they are now translated in nearly each language of the world. Yes, each language of the world. Charaka, Sushruta, Vagbhata has been translated in Marathi language, English language, Hindi language, German language, Spanish language. So don't get afraid. Don't get shocked. Even if you don't know Sanskrit, you will get learned in the first year. And that is not all. Your patients will not test your Sanskrit language. Never, never. There is many, many misconceptions. They get afraid. Even by the teachers. Oh, you must write down the shlokas. If you don't write the shloka, you will get failed. That is totally misconception in the mind of teachers and students. Okay, I agree that there is the importance of shloka verses, but that is not all. If the student is able to write the meaning of that particular Sanskrit shloka in the Marathi, Hindi or English, definitely he should get passed. This is my personal opinion. Okay, now in this particular definition, there are four Sanskrit words or the Hindi or Sanskrit word. Hitakar, beneficial. Which factors are beneficial for my life? Ahitakar, which factors are harmful for my life? Simple things, keeping the social distancing, okay, keep wearing the mask, this is hitakar. And when you don't get the illness of corona, that is sukhakar, happy also. So many times it happens, sometimes wearing the mask is little bit difficult, you know, I get suffocated, I just throw away the mask. That may make you little bit happy, but that is not beneficial for you on a long run. Remember my words. So we should choose the anything in our life which is hitakar as well as sukhakar. Getting up in the morning is hitakar. Sometimes it may not be happy, sukhakar. So we have to make this type of combination. And the most important word in this shloka is mana. Mana means pariman, praman. Because it is many times commented, Ayurveda is a vague science. Ayurveda is only talking about qualitative type of the information. Ayurveda don't have any measurements. This is a totally wrong. In the definition of Ayurveda, they have mentioned the word mana. Mana means measurement. Every aspect. Hitakar things, for example, my lecture, the students are saying, oh, Dr. Deshpande is talking good, we must listen. But if I continue my lecture after even 3 p.m., that cannot be good because there should be quantification. At 3 p.m., you have another video, another virtual tool. So I should stop at 3 o'clock, okay? So that is called as a praman. Ayurveda has explained taking, for example, milk. It's fine for everybody. Taking the ghee, okay. But if anybody starts drinking only milk all the time and lot of ghee and cheese every time, that can be harmful. So good things in taken in appropriate amount, that can be harmful. And even toxin, if it is taken very skillfully, that can be beneficial for our life. You know, many medicines that we are using, even the antibiotics, they are really vicious or toxins. They are converted skillfully into the medicine. Okay, so toxins can be converted skillfully in the medicine, and medicines, if taken in the wrong way, that can be the poison. I hope that you are understanding. What is Ayu? Ayurveda. What is life? Life, sharira Ayu iti jivita kala. From birth to death, this is my life. But it includes sharira indriya sattva atma sanyogo dhari jivitam. I will explain what is that. This is, our life is made up of four factors. Physical body, sharira, indriya, new terminology. I am giving the terminology. Remember my words. Terminology. Indriya means sensory and motor organs. For example, my ears, my nose, my eyes, my skin, my tongue. You know, these are the sensory organs. Okay. So there are, and motor organs also, you know, hands and legs. These are the motor organs. Sattva means mind. And Atma means soul principle. So Ayurveda says our life is made up of physical entities, psychological entities, and metaphysical aspect should be considered when we talk about our own life. Now, when I say Sharira, it's a union of physical body. So what is Sharira? What is Sharira? What is my physical body? That is the only one characteristic. Shiryate tat Shariram, which is having degenerative phenomena. Nobody here to live for all the time in the world. Amaratva, no, not possible. When you are taking the birth, you must die. So this is the process. From birth to death, slowly degeneration will go on. So shiryate tat shariram. Tatra shariram nama chetana adhishtana bhutam pancha mahabhuta vikara samudayatmakam samayogavai. Don't get afraid. I am translating this. What is sharir, physical body? It's a union of chetana, that is life force or energy principle, and Panch Mahabhut. So energy at one level and matter at another level. You know, in physics, world is going on smoothly with the proper union, proper coordination in energy and matter. I hope this is very clear. In this my room, electricity is energy, and what I am using is my laptop is the matter. So if there is no light, no electricity, whether my lecture has been taken place? No. Okay, electricity is there, but my laptop all of a sudden get crashed. Whether I can deliver the lecture? No. Similarly, in the physical body, there must be proper coordination in your life force and five basic elements, that is pancha. Pancha means five, mahabhut. What are the elements? Number one, prithvi, aap, tej, vayu and akash. Parallel terms, prithvi can be considered as earth molecules, aap, water molecules. You know these terms, earth, water, fire, you know these terms. You don't get afraid with these terms. But when I say prithvi, aap, tej, vayu, you get afraid. That's why this lecture is just to make you confidence about the Ayurvedic basic terminology. Now you will say, this is a crazy thing. Bhut. Bhut, Marathi and English conversion is like a ghost. So in the very previous days, we used to, when we visited, in 1994, I started visiting Switzerland, Germany, Italy, and till 2014, 20 years I visited foreign countries from 1 month to 3 months from the God's sake and from many well-wishers. But in this time, there were some problems. How to translate these words? There is always a problem. Some people, by joke we say, some people translate three dosha as a three faults in the body. F-A-U-L-T as fault. No, this is wrong. Wrong translation. Similarly, there are five ghosts in our body. No, this is wrong translation. How that bhut shabda has been arrived? Sanskrit origin. Bhu bhavati. What is meant by bhu bhavati? To exist. So these five elements were exist in the past in the universe, are existing today and will be existing in the future. So they are eternal. They will be permanent. They were there, they are there, and they will be there. That's why bhuta world is there. Exist. Try to understand. And why the maha? Maha means all pervading. Throughout the universe, these elements are existing. That's why bhubhavati word is there. Now, what is the aim of Ayurveda? Swastasya swastha rakshanam, atulasya vyadhi prashamanam cha. Okay? So, these are the objectives of Ayurveda, to maintain the health of healthy person. This is the primary important. Now, what we are doing? We are staying at home. Am I right? Are we anything disease? Are we any problem of health? No, not at all. But still we are staying at home. When we go little bit to purchase any stuff from the market, we wear the mask. We keep the social distancing. When we come, we wash our hands. What is that? That is swastha vritta. Because we say that at the moment we don't have any corona problem, but I do not want to get corona in the near future. We are doing vaccination. What is vaccination? Prevention. We are doing dhupa. Many people are doing fumigation at home. You also can do fumigation of the house. Very important. Then drinking a golden milk in the morning. Turmeric and the milk. That is called the golden milk nowadays. So drinking this thing in the morning, taking tablet Guduchi, Inospora cordifolia, two tablets every day. What is that? That is called as a preventive aspect of Ayurveda. Now government has started Swasthya OPD. Every college, your Jupiter College also, Swasthya OPD. There, what is really expected? The healthy person will come and he will get his checkup, prakriti, genetic makeup, biotype, constitution, who am I, vata, pitta, kapha. And then according to the constitution, the doctor will advise about his food. Doctor will advise about his lifestyle. That is called as a prakriti parikshan and advice. Then in the Swasthya OPD, they give the idea about your body tissues, where I have the anemia, rakta dhatu, whether I have the low weight, mouse dhatu is less, whether my fat is more, obesity is there. So all things are checked over there, dhatu quality, dhatu sarata, and the advice is given. Then Swasthya OPD also talk about 24-hour daily routine, Dinacharya in Ayurveda. Terminology. What is terminology? Dinacharya. That is daily regimen. Here you can see this word, Rutucharya, seasonal regimen. Now this coming in Nagpur, you know, too hot, nearly 40 degrees centigrade. Am I right? So there Ayurveda says garlic is like poison. Garlic is like poison for you people in summer. Alcohol drinking is like poison. Smoking is like poison because heat provokes heat. Eating non-vegetarian, eating spicy food, that is poisonous in the summer season, what Ayurveda has mentioned. Okay, then curative aspect, everybody knows, giving the treatment, but that treatment also includes rasayana chikitsa, tonics for avoiding the recurrence of a disease. Now, when I say to maintain the health of a healthy person, who can be called as a healthy person? Swastha. This is a Sanskrit term, swastha. Who is healthy? That is there. Samadoshaha samagnishcha samadhatu malakriha prasanna atma indriya manah swastha iti abhidyate. Don't get afraid. These Sanskrit lines is like a lipi of that particular language. You know the Malayalam, Telugu lipi, specific style of syllabus. This is very difficult to read. Chinese language, German is very easy because it's very, the alphabets are very similar to the English language. So this is the script of Ayurveda. Samadosha, Samagni. I will explain what is that. The important word is a sam. Don't forget this word. Sam. Sam is nothing but the balance. Here you can see. Swastha means healthy. And this word, every student is knowing in your college. Because he has heard about in 12th standard, in 11th standard about homeostasis. Every student knows about this homeostasis. Ayurvedic sama concept is nothing but the homeostasis. So balance of gross elements. Which are the gross elements in my body? Dosha, that is bioenergies. Dhatu, body tissues. Mala, waste products. And Agni, digestive fires. But this is not the only idea. Ayurveda says there should be balance in subtle elements. Why they are subtle? Because you cannot immediately test them. You cannot see by your senses immediately. Their examination is very, very difficult. That's why they are called subtle elements. Indriya, balance, sensory and motor organs. Man, that is mind. Atma, that is soul principle. What is dosha, dhatu and mala? Dosha, dushayanti iti doshaha, which will spoil to the other body elements. They are not always spoiling the doshas are very good. They are excellent. They are like the God. Vata, pitta, kapha are like God for our health. But at the same time, they can be demon. Why? In physiological conditions, dosha are behaving like God, making your physiology. But dosha, vata, pitta, kapha, bioenergies, when they get vitiated, when they get angry, they can kill your body tissues. That is the power. Physiologically, they are like God. And pathologically, they are like demon. Remember these words. That is why they are called as dosha. Actually, prakrutyarambhakatve sati dushtikartutva. They are responsible for forming our genetic makeup. Prakruti, very important word in Ayurveda. I visited 20 years to the European countries only because of this word. Yes, it is true. Because these foreigners are very, very crazy to know what is, doctor, tell me, what is my prakriti in Ayurveda? Am I vata? Am I pitta? Am I kapha? So that prakriti is very interesting topic when you go ahead and you will learn in detail. Dhatu, dharana, dhatavaha. They will maintain, these elements will maintain our body from birth to death. Dharana means to maintain. Maintain physiology, of course. Malini karanat malaha. The waste products which will spoil your systems. Waste products will spoil. I am saying will spoil. When they will not be taken out of the body. Now here, doshas, bioenergies, they are actually placed with the help of these body organs and systems. Whenever necessary, they are poured in the lumen. For example, in my mouth there is a saliva. Do you know saliva? Yes, everybody knows. When I speak a lot, my saliva is poured. According to Ayurveda, this is bodhaka kapha. Kapha is secreted. When I will finish my lecture and I will keep quiet for 1 hour, my saliva will be go into the salivary gland. There will not more secretion. So energies are always coming, setting down, coming, settling down. Dhatu are permanently structures like RCC construction, and mala are expected to go out of the body. For example, urine, stool and sweat. For example, if your urine is not passed properly, if the patient is suffering from anuria, oliguria, prostate enlargement, obstruction, kidney failure, and urine is retained in the body, what will happen? Yes, uremia, E-M-I-A, emia means blood, and urea is a waste product of protein metabolism. Yes, you know. So urea in is urine. When urea is not going, urea is staying in the blood. That is uremia. And that patient can be unconscious. Patient can die. You know, so that is the importance of mala. Simple thing, if you don't have a good morning every day, that means you don't pass the stools properly, constipated, heart stool, what will happen? Gas will be there, oh, uncomfortable, not feeling well. So the importance of mala has also been mentioned by Ayurveda very critically. Vata, pitta and kapha, what are the? What is vata? Vata is like these, all the energies, bioenergies are representing the universal energy. Bioenergies are representative of universal energy. Are you getting my point? So vata is parallel to the kinetic energy, like the wind energy, because it is representing the wind energy in the universe. Vata energy is responsible for all types of movements. All types of movements. Now I am making my hands like this. I am speaking with my mouth. Movement is there. Vata is there. My heart is beating. Yes, my heart is beating. That is because of the vata. My peristaltic movements are going on because I have taken the lunch. So that is because of the vata. So gross movements and subtle movements, respiratory rate, cardiac heart sounds, all because of the vata. Nerve impulse. My brain is giving signal to the Broca's area is here, and it is giving signal to my larynx. Speak out, speak out. What is that? Nervous system is mainly related with the vata bioenergy, nerve impulse. Sensory and motor activities are related with vata dosha. What is pitta dosha? It is like the thermal energy, heat principle in the body. And that is representing sun. Sun is a universal energy. And that energy is representing by pitta dosha in our body. And what is the function of your gas and the stove and the fire? Conversion, all types of transformation, digestion, metabolism is depend on pitta dosha. Your indigestion takes place when your fire, digestive fire, agni is not good. Enzymes are not good. Then that is related with the enzymes, hormones. All these things can be correlated with pitta dosha in Ayurveda. Okay, even whatever I am teaching right now to you, there is a pitta in your brain. There is a pitta in your brain. And that pitta is called as sadhaka pitta. So capacity of everybody's fire is different. Some may have very strong fire. Some have a weak fire. So whenever the students having the strong fire, they will have the good concentration on the Professor Deshpande's lecture, very sharp intelligence. And they will grasp each and every word what I am teaching to them. So your teacher may be taking post-assessment, you know, after the seminars, they will ask you to write down the feedback. So everybody has to remember, oh, lot of terminology. Deshpande sir has told lot of, but I remember panchama, bhut, I remember swast, I remember vata, pitta, kapha. At least this much you should know from this particular lecture. Kapha dosha is like mechanical energy. And it is representing the moona principle. One, sun is a heating principle and moon is a cooling principle. In the day, metabolic rate is very fast, very aggressive. And in the night, what is happening? Parasympathetic system. So everything is going down, but at the same time, do you know? When you sleep, there is a good function of growth hormone. So in the sleep, in the resting condition, kapha is a predominant because kapha dosha is responsible for maintenance of the body, for the stability of the body, for the lubrication of the body, for the growth of the body. Growth hormone acting more at night. Remember this thing. If you sleep late at night every day at 12, 1 p.m., you will be having early aging. Your hair will fall down, gray hair will be there, you may have some heart attack at the age of 30. So be careful. Night sleep is for kapha dosha. Balancing is recharging your battery. In the whole day, your pitta and vata are working more and more and more. Hectic day. Fast food, fast life. By joke, I always say to my all the students, remember always this equation. Fast food plus fast lifestyle is equal to, yes, fast death. Remember this equation and always tell to your patient, fast food plus fast lifestyle is equal to fast death, early aging. So remember this, there should be a balance of vata, pitta and kapha. They are very, very good, you know, the family people. In any our family, there may be a quarrel in between the brothers. There may be quarrel between brother and sister. There may be quarrel between father and son. But these vata, pitta, kapha are enjoying their life very, very cleverly. Only you, the people, you are disturbing this vata, pitta and kapha. So be careful how to maintain this vata, pitta, kapha. Dhatu, body tissues. Rasa, rakta, mans, med, asti, majja, shukra. Ayurvedic terminology, Ayurvedic language. We have to accept it. Parallel words. I have given the parallel. Rasa can be compared with all types of the liquid in our body. It may be plasma. It may be lymph. It may be intracellular, extracellular fluid. Water electrolyte balance is done by rasa dhatu in Ayurveda. In this summer season, in your Nagpur, 40 degrees centigrade, what will happen? Which dhatu will be affected? Rasa dhatu will be affected. Dehydration is loss of rasa dhatu. Next is rakta. Rakta is the blood cells. Like for example, neutrophil, eosinophil, that all WBCs and mainly RBCs, hemoglobin. That can be correlated with rakta concept of Ayurveda, which is responsible for proper oxygenation. So when rakta dhatu is less, naturally the person is suffering from anemia and he starts breathlessness. Mausa dhatu, muscle tissue that is responsible for covering your body and all types of the movements, hands movement, legs movement, joint movements, they are controlled, they are helped by the mausa dhatu. Muscular ligaments, tendons, all these are part of the mausa dhatu. Medh dhatu can be correlated with fatty tissue or adipose tissue. That is the storage energy. You know, fat is the storage energy. Then asthi. Asthi is the osseous tissue or the bones. And bones are for support. You know, your vertebral column is the main part which make you stretch. When at aging, vertebral column becomes bent and that you are holding the body is becoming problematic. Asthi sandhi, bony joints, knee joint, what is that? It's a part of asthi dhatu. Because in the old age, your bone degeneration takes place. Osteoporosis, you know that, osteoporosis. This is a problem according to Ayurveda with the Asthi Dhatu. Majja can be compared with bone marrow as well as can be compared with the nervous tissue, because whatever the brain is there, it is in the cranium. So brain is filled in the cranial cavity. So as this particular tissue, nervous tissue, is inside. So that is, according to Ayurveda, it's like filling the cavities of bones and cranium, all these things, going inside and staying over there, nerve conduction. So Majja Dhatu can be compared with all these of nervous system type of the activities. Shukra, yes, male gamete and female gamete, as you know very well, spermatozoa and ovum, that is a reproductive tissue. But try to understand, Ayurveda says that reproductive tissue is not concerned only with the progeny, cellular regeneration. If anybody is clever to remember this word, cellular regeneration is also connected, according to Ayurveda, with Shukra Dhatu. Because if all these tissues are very good, your immunity will be good. And Ayurveda, the essence of all body tissues is called Oja in Ayurveda. Oja, terminology. Oja concept is very similar concept to the immunity concept of modern medicine. Oja, remember this word. Mala, mutra can be compared with urine, purish can be compared with the stool, and sveda can be compared with sweat. Now, here, one interesting thing, many students who are from English medium, they are confused with this word purusha, because there is two words in the Ayurveda, purusha and purisha, only little difference. But this word is purisha and not purusha. So the teachers will explain you afterwards. Then, what is the disease and what is the health? Vikara means dhatu vaishamyam, dosha samyam arogata. So here, the vikara, what is the terminology? Vikara means disease. Vikara means disease, illness, imbalance, loss of homeostasis, that is vikara in Ayurveda. And why this is taking place? Dhatu vaishamyam. Samya means equilibrium, balance, homeostasis. And vaishamya, loss of homeostasis. If in corona, I get the attack of corona and my body temperature rises, you know, we are checking now, right? Digital thermometer. Everybody knows now. Oximeter. Okay. So when I suffer from corona, my body temperature will be showing some 40 degrees Fahrenheit, that is going above 100 degrees. Sorry, this is centigrade, above 100 degrees Fahrenheit. So this fever is one of the loss of homeostasis and possibility of vikar. What is that vikar in nowadays? Corona, COVID-19. So you should be cautious about vikar, dhatu vaishamya. Dhatu means only not rasarakta mausme. Here, vaishamya in any of the things. Imbalance in vata pitta kapha, imbalance in rasa rakta mouse made, anything. Imbalance in mutra purisha sved, anything. Imbalance in mind. Imbalance in sensory and motor organs. And all these dosha, dhatu, mala, indriya, man, if they are in a balanced state, samyavastha, then that is a part of arogya. Arogata. Arogata means arogya. Roga is equal to disease. Roga is equal to disease. And arogata, no disease. And what is no disease? Healthy. Simple things to remember, okay? Now, you will say, sir, what is this? What is this? Yes, this is the names of the subject. That is also a part of terminology, because many students, they get confused with this some terms. Sanskrit is one of the subject of your first year BMS, which can be called as the mother tongue of Ayurveda, which is the language of the Samhita Granthas like Charaka, Sushruta, Vagbhata. These are the names of reference books of Ayurveda, not textbook. Whatever Dr. Vaghe sir has written, whatever Dr. Deshpande has written, whatever has been written by your madam, that is textbook. But original reference books are our Samhita. Good collection of information is called as Samhita, compendium. Plural is compendia. So all the original texts are in Sanskrit, but don't worry, every translation is available. Okay? But if you learn Sanskrit by heart and very kindness, you will be more delighted to learn this Ayurveda. Padartha Vijnana, This is a particular subject which talks about the basic elements on the earth, basic elements in our body, because padarth, padasya artha padartha, which is named by a particular name, that elements, the discussion on the elements, and that too, TWO, in addition to the philosophical aspect behind those particular elements, philosophical aspects, philosophical theories. Ayurveda is not only a, what you can say, the practical, that is a practical medical science, but it has a philosophical background. And that's why that science, this Ayurveda science, is becoming eternal. Eternal, this word is very important. In Ayurveda, it is called as a Shashwat. Shashwat, that is eternal. Remain all the time. Ayurveda was there 5,000 years back. Ayurveda is today and Ayurveda will be there. Past, present and future. How, why this is happening? Because of this fundamental principle. Because of the Siddhanta. Because of the philosophical background. And that's why you must take interest in learning Padartha Vidyan subject. Ashtanga Hridaya is one of the important texts. I particularly call this book as a reference book, as a practitioner's guide. Yes, in the South India, many families who are practicing this Ayurveda, they learn Ashtanga Hridaya full by heart. Whole, all the material is there on the tip of the tongue. It is also the small than Charaka and Sushrut. So it is very, and it is in a poetry form. So it is very easy to mug up and learn. So anybody of you is really, really interested. Of course, I know everybody is interested. To practice pure Ayurveda, they must learn by heart Ashtanga Hridaya total, from first chapter to the last chapter of all the sthana. In the first year, don't get afraid. It is only Sutra sthana. Only 30 chapters are there. Okay, Rachana Sharira, Rachana, construction, structure, Ayurvedic and modern anatomical aspect. Fortunately, your course is made up of both amalgamation or union of Ayurveda and allopathy, modern knowledge as well. Kriya Sharira, it's Ayurvedic and modern physiology, functioning. Anatomy is a structure which you learn even by dissection. Very interesting. You will have to dissect the body. And this is, you know, Rachana Sharira is basically based on Sushruta Samhita. And Sushrut, this particular Rishi, scientist of Ayurveda, is reclaimed, is honored from the modern surgical books as well. Modern surgery, modern surgical aspect, modern surgical people, they admire this Sushruta as a father of surgery. Father of surgery is Sushrut from Ayurveda fraternity. Okay. Second year BMS, you will have the Dravya Guna Vijnana subject, which is related with Ayurvedic herbology. You will learn a lot of plants. Modern pharmacology also there is included, anti-hypertensive drugs. Rasa Shastra and Vaishajya Kalpana. Rasa word is for mercury. Rasa Shastra is alchemical science, pharmacology of herbal mineral products, and how to prepare the medicines. You will learn pharmacy also. Roga Nidana Vikruti Vijnana subject from your master teacher, Dr. Subhash Wagher sir, who is a potent, what you can say, the well-known, knowledgeable person in this regard. Ayurvedic and modern pathology. I request all of you, in the second year, you must purchase Dr. Wagher sir's book. It's excellent book. Excellent. You will get the review of this book on my channel. Charaka Purvardha. Huh? Purvardha means first part. What is said in Ayurveda? Charakastu Chikitsite. Those who want to practice Ayurvedic internal medicine, they must be aware of this Charaka Samhita very well. Well understanding of Charaka Samhita. Third year BMS, you will get Agata Tantra and Vyavahara Ayurveda. That is toxicology and medical jurisprudence. Swasthavritta, we have discussed a lot, which can be compared with the PSM, preventive and social medicine, from the modern MBBS course. Prasuti Tantra and Stree Roga, that is gynecology and obstetrics. Then Kaumara Vritya Tantra. I know, these are all the terminologies, is very difficult to remember, but you will remember within a month. Kaumara Vritya Tantra, Balaro, pediatrics. Charaka Uttarardha, that is Charakastu Chikitsite, second part, best reference book for internal medicine. Fourth of the final students, Kaya Chikitsa subject, very interesting. Ayurvedic and modern internal medicine, Panchakarma, five processing, purificatory processes, that is detox therapy, Shalya Tantra, Ayurvedic and modern surgery. Don't get shocked. as I have just now told you, that Sushruta, who is the originator of the Shalya Tantra, is being rewarded, is being admired from the modern fraternity as a father of surgery. In Ayurveda, there are few surgeries which are now world famous. Remember this word, Kshara Sutra treatment. Surgery without knife. Surgery without knife. Chemical cauterization for fistula in ano. The name of the disease, fistula in ano. Then Shalakya Tantra, Ayurvedic and modern ENT and ophthalmology. Research methodology. This is new subject entered in the last 5-7 years. And medical statistics. Because by this subject, you must aware of your further progress in our life. You Ayurvedic students can now do MD, MS and PhD in any subject of Ayurveda. So my dear friends, now on my clock, there is 3:55. So I hope I have completed my lecture within short timing, started at 2 p.m. and ending at 3 p.m. I thank you all, Dr. Vaghe sir. Thank you very much.